Dr. Swami is a general physician. In his 20 years of practice, he has earned reputation and money by delivering the best patient care possible. Now here comes the problem, the coronavirus. And the scenario is somewhat like this. The doctor can't see you today. He will connect you on social media. And this, having all this information on my patient's diagnosis, I think I need a degree in data analytics to sort it out. And then this, we now have stay-at-home teleradiologists, telepsychiatrists, telepathologists, telephysicians, and teleanesthesiologists. No, it's still not happening for the anesthesiologist. But this certainly has some warm welcomings too. You don't even have to put your pants on to see the patient, isn't it? The present is changing very rapidly, and you got to move with the flow. Like Dr. Swami, there are numerous doctors in the country who are facing this problem. The government of India and MCI have finally woken up to the threat arising out of fragmented healthcare, which can only be sorted out by using the technology in the right way. Telemedicine and electronic health records are the future of healthcare. And how do they help? They basically re-suture the broken links in the healthcare data. Now, if your patient is finding out ways to sue you, then you shouldn't blame telemedicine and technology for the same. Anyways, he can even sue you without using these two technologies. Every new beginning brings pros and cons in the flow. Let's have a look at what MCI guidelines have to say about using the telemedicine for your clinic. Here are some of the important points you must know before practicing telemedicine on any platform. Number 1. Telemedicine applies to all the modes of electronic communication between the doctor and the patient. That includes real-time online video consultation, which is also a video call, audio consultation through phone, text messages using any messaging platform like WhatsApp, or in the form of any digital data exchange. Number 2. You can extend help to the patients in emergency only when they are present in front of a registered medical practitioner at their earliest, and also seeking your help through telemedicine as a first aid or a life-saving measure. Number 3. Whenever during the telemedicine call, you feel that the patient needs a proper physical examination, you have all the right to terminate the teleconsultation and ask the patient to visit your clinic. You also have the right to deny any patient for teleconsultation anytime. Number 4. Identification of your patient is essential. You must be able to see the patient's particulars, including his or her phone number, and you should also display your medical registration number on the platform which you are using for telemedicine. Number 5. The patient's consent is always taken as implied when the patient calls you. It is obviously true in most of the cases. In simple words, when a patient walks into your OPD, the consent for the consultation is taken as implied. It is a similar situation when the patient requests for a telemedicine call to a doctor, the consent is already taken as implied. Number 6. There are two types of consultations with the patient. First consult and the follow-up consult. Both of them have different explanations. So, rather than reading out here, I am just posting a screenshot here for you to pause and read this. Number 7. Now, prescription has some really nasty concerns. Again, rather than reading it out, pause this video and check out the screenshot on what you can prescribe. One special note on this purpose is, try to consult or counsel the patient over the teleconsultation and avoid sending the prescription to the patient. In case if you need to prescribe the drugs to the patient, which you are actually not sure if it is allowed or not, just counsel the patient and ask him to come to your clinic for a detailed physical examination. This way you can be sure of to avoid any legal hassles in your practice. Number 8. A log register should be maintained by the doctor, listing all data regarding the teleconsultation with the patient. This will even help you out in fetching your earned money neatly from the telemedicine platform provider. You can prepare the logbook in your Google Sheet or Google Docs, which can easily be shared across all platforms and are super easy to edit and maintain your records. If you need any help in this logbook issue, do write to me at docnavneetgoyal@gmail.com. It is docnavneetgoyal@gmail.com, and I will be happy to respond you back. I will also help you to preserve the digital data in your account, even when the tech platform provider doesn't have one. Point number 9. As per point 3.7.3, you can charge your consultation fees for the telemedicine consultation with the patient, and it is your responsibility to provide the receipt to the patient. This is a complicated scenario where the telemedicine platform provider will be extracting the amount and sending you the payouts of your earnings through telemedicine calls, probably by the end of the month or so. So it would be very difficult to send bills to all the patients you consult. In my opinion, the doctor should send receipts to the patients consulted over the telemedicine platform in the bulk at the end of every month. This way you can be sure to settle any disputes that arise from the patient's end on the transaction related issues. Point number 10. There is a sample format for the prescription which is shown here in front of your screen. You have to use the platform which integrates all these relevant points. It includes the chief complaints, relevant points from the history, examination of the lab findings, suggested investigations, special instructions, provisional diagnosis, drugs to be prescribed. This is a complete format which we medicos usually use to write the prescription. So I hope you must have found the video very simple to understand. If you have any queries, do write to me at docnavneetgoyal@gmail.com. Have a great day ahead.